o'clock on a Wednesday, and this is the Wizard Product Review. I'm Dave.
And I'm Sean.
And on this week's show, we've got a work of the week coming up, but first of all, we've got an item called Float by Sans Minds, introduced by Chris.
Introduced by Chris, and not only this, I've read the DVD, I've seen the advertising. This is a mini illusion.
Yeah, Chris has been sleeping rough for a few days and decides to pop onto the trailer to tell us how levitations are classic illusions in magic, and they are, you know, and I think they've got a picture of Dante or somebody like that. Well, I think it's Thurston, isn't it? And he's going, and the girl's floating up, and he announces to the magic community that finally available through Sans Minds Magic is a levitation of this standard that you can carry in your wallet. Talk about the effect.
Basically, what happens is, you open the wallet and then you show your money or your credit card and you make it float up in the air. It kind of really disappointed me a little bit.
When levitation is one of those holy grail magic effects and you can now do it in your wallet anytime.
I tell you what this reminds me of, I suppose, and we have not discussed this, suddenly remembered something. I was reading a magic book when I was a kid, and it told you how to make a playing card or your credit card float by putting something on the back of the card that you bend, right?
And
I took it to school and I started doing it, and people were guessing there was something underneath the thing that I was trying to make float, which is a similar experience, because I took this out, and the closest I could get, I opened it up and I showed somebody at the gym, and they thought that the card was coming up on a spring.
Yeah.
They thought when I opened
the
wallet,
there's
kind
a spring underneath.
Yeah.
I was there when he said that. And also, I showed somebody the video, said, how do you think that's done? He said, well, there's a hole in the wallet and he's pushing it up with his finger.
Ta-da!
It's actually not a bad theory. This is not how it's done. You get a gimmick in here.
And to compare this to a portable floating trick that's easy to do, for example, the floating match.
Yeah.
So you put the match on the playing card and you make it float. What's great about that is you can prove there's nothing above holding the match up, and you can prove that there's nothing below. People can see above the match and they can see below the match. With this, if somebody wants to have a look below the object that's floating, they can't. You've got to end the tricking. Oh, sorry, can't do that anymore.
Apparently, that's good enough from the live performance. And when you talk about a live performance on a Sans Minds DVD, you know, it's very late night in Vancouver. And I'm starting to have suspicions about these live performances because I really genuinely can't see how people would react to this effect in the way that they react. And, you know, fair enough. We said, didn't we, if we go public and we say Sans Minds would just come back and say, well, you're obviously not good performance.
Yeah, good performance, enough performance to get the
which
reaction.
Is a great out if that's the way you're going to go. But the thing is, the performance is, okay, all chant, Jason is magic, Jason is magic, Jason is magic. And while that happens, and they're saying, Jason is magic, Jason is magic, Jason is magic, he opens up his wallet, it floats up, and these people...
Wait. Look at it, have a look at it.
Oh my God. Well, we even commented that
David
the reaction was
Blaine
stronger. Yeah.
Did not get as good a reaction when he floated above the streets of New York. Or wherever it was, I think it was New York, I'm not sure. Anyway, when he did that levitation off the ground and everybody went crazy, right? Jason is getting a much better reaction from from doing, and I don't mean to offend anybody, but I call it a toy shop trick. With his wallet, because, and the reason I call it a toy shop trick is because I think this is something that looks like a kind of cool special effect if you're doing it to yourself in front of the mirror, like kids might do with magic tricks that they buy from the shops. I don't necessarily think this is something that a professional should be out there working.
I think, it's just a guess, but I think those people watching, when they're watching Jason, I think they've been like spoken to. I don't know. I think, you know, and it's still 14 days since we asked Sans Minds to produce that other bit of footage to show that switch that they were going to do the switch with the token thing, but they didn't do that switch because they were using other techniques.
Are you suggesting that maybe Jason might have known these people
I don't
before
know.
He went up and did the trick.
I don't know. Or they've had a little bit of a pre... Like everybody when they're filming a video, everybody goes, come on, we need you to react. We need you to go, yeah. Whoa, like this.
Hi, guys. There's two magicians working here tonight and we're having a competition to see who can cheer the loudest.
Yeah, cheer the loudest. And whoever cheers the loudest will buy you all drinks if you all
the
cheer.
The worse the trick, the louder you cheer.
When you open your
and
wallet...
And they cheered loud for this
it's,
one.
It's kind of the wrong reaction in a way, isn't it? Not again.
You don't want that reaction from
not,
levitation.
It's not the reaction you're after, is it? When you basically go in, you're opening your wallet and people are going, ah, look.
Yeah.
That's not the reaction, is it?
That's not the levitation reaction. A levitation reaction, as it's going up and everything, it's like, oh my God, is that...
Well,
oh,
what
man.
Happens in the spectator's mind, first of all, they see the effect, the levitation. Then they're almost looking for proof. They're looking for, how is that floating? Now, the problem with this trick is they know something's going on and you can't let them see it. You just have to, like you say, close it.
And
but
what's happening in the spectator's mind is they're going, what is he doing?
Yeah. That's why? What they're really
doing.
They're
not doing. Saying, how are you doing it? They're saying, why are you doing
and
it?
And how loud do I have to scream again to get my free drinks?
Yeah.
I don't know. There's something going on, but the spectator, when they see a levitation, they watch it, they see the levitation, then you need the proof. As an illusionist, you know this. You can't just say that person is floating, because they go, how are they floating? You need the silk to go over the top. You need the ring to go around.
At least,
you need something to go underneath
they
and
at least
go like this.
Need to see underneath it.
Yeah, and like you said, the floating match is actually a better trick than this.
Much, much better trick.
This is a terrible trick. I think it's probably one of the worst tricks I've ever seen on the Wizard product review. And it is seriously making me doubt these live performances that are shown on Sans Minds DVDs. Because I just don't think it's a genuine reaction. And yet, there it is on film. And still 14 days since we saw the other footage with questions. Let's deal with that before you start having a go at us as performers, and we would get these reactions if we were better performers. 0%.
Yeah, 0%.
It can't be any better because the audience knows how it's done.
It can be better. It can be a lot better.
Yeah, just do floating match.
Yeah. And next up we've got Nick Einhorn presents Antonio Romero's Bill Tamarca by Vanishing
Ink. In association with Vanishing Ink. Probably the standout trick of the Blackpool Magic Convention. Certainly a lot of people around Nick's table all the time watching him dem this. And do you want to summarise the effect and kind of what you get with it?
Basically, somebody signs a banknote, the banknote disappears, and then the banknote actually then reappears in the pen that they use to sign it with.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. And it's a really strong piece of magic. A really strong piece of magic. You get two pens with it. You get the real pen, you get the gimmick pen, and you get, I think, downloadable instructions. Which is really good. They cover all different types of vanishes for the bill. And it works. It's really good quality. And like Nick says on the video, this will last a lifetime. I'm sure it will.
It's very well made. Obviously, Nick credits Antonio because he's been using Antonio's version for many, many years. And then Nick has bought the rights and the rights to produce this. He's had the gimmicked pen made locally. It is made very, very well. And it's got a very cool feature as well. I know Nick's proud of this. The fact that you can reset it very, very quickly and very, very easily with just things you've got on you that you use as part of the routine. And when you talk about the routine, I think this is something that people like about Nick Einhorn's stuff. When you consider the Nesta wallets, for example, yes, it was something that had come out before, but now it's like everybody that's performing it, everybody's using it. They're using Nick's routine. It's like it's like become a modern classic. And I think that's why when Nick Einhorn brings something out, people tend to go, oh, what's this then? And they tend to pay attention.
Yep.
And you can see from the multiple live performances on the video download and on the trailer in full that Nick has performed this. You can see he's worked it. And you can see how the presentation flows. And you can see how the way that the routine is structured and just the little performance tips that he gets about how to ask for the pen back but not ask for it, if you know what I mean,
yeah.
If you've seen this project already.
Creating offbeat.
That convinces them that pen's kind of never been left out.
Yeah.
You could easily re-routine it if you wanted to, so the pen was on the table all the time if you've got a little bit of, you know, magical knowledge.
That's what I was saying. I've already got a routine that this would top and tail quite nice. I'm going to do it slightly differently to what Nick teaches it on the DVD. And that's what's great about it. This is a utility device. Yeah. You can use Nick's routine. Nick's going, okay, here's the routine that I do. You don't have to do that. You can go, yes, brilliant, I've got my own thing with that. And go, you know, if you're the creative type, you can go and do your own thing with it.
Yeah, it's a very easy way to make a bill switch that you might be doing already into a routine. Rather than you just doing a series of tricks, you could do your bill switch, then at the end of it, the note vanish, you do another routine, and then at the end of it, you go back and the pen's been on the table all the time, or they've been holding it or whatever, and the bill is discovered inside. The gimmick is made very, very well. You can't say anything bad about this. It's a great project. It really is a great project. I know Nick was very, very busy selling them at Blackpool, people going up to his table all the time. And when you see it, you realise how good it is. I wasn't sure about it at the time when I first saw it. I thought, do I need to carry another pen around? Am I going to bother with that? But having seen the video download, having seen how well it works, what I'm referring to there is actually where the pen is stored prior to the loading procedure. That for me made it. That was the bit where I went, oh my God, that's what makes it so quick. And I didn't understand it before. I thought it was swimming around in your pocket. But when you see where it's actually positioned prior to the loading procedure, it gives you a lot of confidence that, oh my God, I can literally load this thing in seconds.
And I think Nick makes a point on the DVD as well. It doesn't take up a lot of pocket space. No. And what it can do, which is what this has done for me, I've got like my A material and my B material, and there's in one of my B sets, there's a routine that can be top and tailed by this that actually makes it, it adds that really strong bit of magic to it rather than just, oh, that was nice. It's a strong bit of magic. So if you've got something where you're already having something signed, already having a banknote signed, already doing a bill switch, then this is a really nice way that instantly resets as well. As soon as this goes back in your pocket, it resets
in front
instantly.
Of the spectators as you're walking between tables seconds.
So bam, so you've got that strong item to impossible location resetting instantly. You can't beat it.
How much are you going to give it?
96%.
I'm going to give it 100%. It has to be 100% because it's such good quality. The gimmick is first class. I actually think this is better than Nest of Wallets.
Oh, I don't do Nest of Wallets. It doesn't fit into anything I do. I've looked at this as a utility device and I've gone, you know
Nest
what?
Nest of Wallets, yeah, for me,
that's
great,
going into that
great
routine.
Tricks, great routines. This looks like what it's meant to look like. You can convince them the pen's been on the table all the time. We're actually giving this a Worker of the Week. So we've got a Worker Special as well. You may remember a while ago, this is limited as well. John has asked us to say, we're going to say that, John, that it's limited and it's really first come, first served. But if it's available, if it's on our website and it says you can order these, you will get, if you order before midnight on Friday, Niphone, which is all the iPhone tricks with
the charging it up,
all those really cool effects to do with the iPhone. I think it was like a £25 DVD or something like that to start with, just for this week and this week only. If you order this from worldmagicshop.com, order the Bill to Marker from Nick Einhorn, you will get Niphone shipped with your order absolutely free, and that's exclusive to worldmagicshop.com, but limited in supply. And from one of the worst products we've seen in a long time to one of the best.
And next up, Shufton Magic presents Fobulous.
Fobulous. So it's a trick with a fob, something I've not been adverse
useless.
To over the years.
Fob useless.
And
fob useless.
You don't get a routine on video, downloadable video or a DVD. You get a booklet with
but
it.
But I prefer magic coming like this anyway. I really enjoy learning from it. And I know I'm smiling because I know what's inside that. But aside from that, I really enjoy learning magic this way. This is how I learned magic when I was growing up. And what's nice about learning magic from a booklet, you then end up performing your own interpretation of the trick rather than copying the guy on the DVD. And I thought that was a really nice way to learn. So I know a lot of youngsters nowadays, they're sort of committed.
You're not referring to me being a poor imitation of David Williamson for 10 years of my life, are you?
You.
Well, and you were Bill Malone for at least 3 years. Yes.
Exactly, and nobody needs that. They need to be learning from the books and then going out and doing your own thing with it. Then you've got no options.
So what this is, in essence, although you can't really tell from the trailer, because the trailer's pretty weak, to be honest with you. It's like, oh, I've just got to put something together. There it is. Boom, just on the kitchen table, just filmed. It's a couple of key fobs. And it's a copper-silver routine. Would that be fair to say?
It is. It's exactly that. A copper-silver routine. But is it a routine or more of a trick that you... It's a routine. It's not a routine, because a routine gives the impression that there's different stages in it. What happens with this is that you can see the two different designs on the key fobs. One's got a black design, one's got a red design. You put them in the spectator's hands, and they change places. Yeah. That's the full routine. And it says it resets at the end, and you can go and do it. You can do it on the person, and you can keep doing it on them, and do it over and over again on them until they just give in. And that's what it says.
I think it's got some positives.
Actually, let me read just what it says at the end of this. I want to read something.
Okay.
In the
effect
extended.
Stephen can't change this.
This is at the end. What happens at the end? It says most often the spectator screams or yells. All can be examined again. I'm not quite sure what they're screaming or yelling.
Maybe he's working with the same audience as Jason is Magic.
They're going, Jason, no more, please stop.
Right, the positives with this, if you're happy to carry these fobs around, that's another story, is that at the start of the routine, both fobs can be examined.
Yeah.
Fair to say, isn't it? You can then freely display these two fobs, which are both examined, nothing else in your hands, and you can go into the routine.
Yeah.
At the end of it, both fobs can be examined and you can left be completely clean. I think that's the nice thing about it. What I don't like are these fobs.
It just looks a bit naff. And I think the fact that you're introducing a prop like this, it needs to do more than what it's actually doing.
Yeah.
Because you kind of go in, you just go, hey, I've got these two fobs, and then you're doing that, and then nothing, you know, it either needs a lot more going on afterwards.
It's not even three phases, is it?
No, that's the trick.
The way it's described is just...
You do the trick.
Put both fobs in your hand, take one out, put it in their hand, and then they change places, that's it.
That's the effect, as it's described.
It does work. The gimmick works okay. It actually looks okay close up. They look like quality props.
Yeah, the effect is described.
They certainly do look like quality props. But it's whether you'd be happy enough to have these if you can make them make sense. And I don't want to harp on about it too much, but going back to Nick Einhorn's... built to marker, it looks like what it's meant to be. It doesn't look out of place.
I think if it looked a bit cooler, and it's like, how can you take this method and bring it into everyday objects?
I know what you do.
It's already been done.
You just use coins.
It's called copper silver coins, or you know, that type of thing, or USB drives, or you know,
it's all better.
It's modern.
And even that's even Flash by Chad Long is a more of a phased routine with a growing one at the end.
Yeah, that's a proper routine, and it's more of that style of thing going on rather than a copper silver routine. But if I was going to do this, I'd do it with coins.
Yeah. If you like these fobs, right, the gimmick works very, very well. If you like these fobs and you're happy to use them and you've got a use for this, you will not be disappointed, because the gimmick works really well. For us, though, it just doesn't feel right. It's not something we want to carry around. But you might like it. But it's not a terrible trick. It's just not a great trick. I'll give it 62%.
That's generous.
I know, but it's like, somebody might like it, and I'm making that clear. I definitely don't want to do it. But it's not a bad trick.
My granddad.
And the trick would fool people.
My granddad has.
Unlike float.
Here you go. I figured it out.
this awful people.
My granddad has got a key fob like that.
Yeah.
Right? And so has my grandma.
Yeah.
Right? So what he does, to make it look impromptu and natural, he says to, you know, they're out on the town, you know, at Hacienda or whatever, and he says, hey, grandma, can I borrow your key fob as well? And then he's got his own and what looks like grandpa.
And grandpa, they check them
They've got an impromptu miracle. At the bus stop, they could do that. And it'd be brilliant. They'd be getting... Well, they don't...
So you like it even more now? How much are you going to give it?
Well, now that... Well, the problem is my granddad's not a magician, though, so he wouldn't do it. So So 41%.
41%. I think that's fair. But don't get us wrong. If you like the close-ups and you like the effect, it's all right. It's a good trick. It's just not as organic as copper silver. Finally this week, we've got Christopher Wheel.
RIP.
Which stands for? Do you remember?
Wheel?
No, RIP. What does it stand for? Do you remember?
Rest in peace.
Restoration in progress. Restoration in progress, and or just RIP, like you say, because it's what it actually is. Christopher Wheel came up with a very good effect, and I always mention this whenever it comes on the Wizard Product Review, or Christopher comes on the Wizard Product Review. It was All That Will Be Consumed, which he brought out with Paper Crane many, many years ago. I always like this effect very, very much, and I always feel obliged to mention that whenever Christopher Wheel... It's basically putting anything in a bottle. It's really good, like pens and that kind of thing. But it was a technique he came up with. And
when
he
does
it, yeah, I've seen him do it live at like a magic convention. I think it was Magic Live a few years ago, and he was just stood there doing it. I'm like, that looks really, really good. This is a brand new effect, a brand new project, and it's a torn and restored card. Always popular. In plot, many, many different versions of it over the years. Michael Chatterlain's probably one of my favourites for doing on a screen or something like that. But this is a very different sort of torn and restored card. I want to talk first of all about what it looks like to the spectator. So they have a card chosen, you see that card front and back, and you
rip it up. Is it two rips or three rips?
You make two or three rips.
Yeah.
And then the great thing is about this is what you're getting in this little package here is a gimmick. And the gimmick makes the restoration work for you.
I suppose what's nice about this is with other torn and restores, you maybe have to hide some pieces at the end and stuff like that. With this, there's none of that. So the gimmick allows you to tear up and then visually restore. And at the end,
It's not signed, is it?
It's not signed. But you're not left with lots of extra pieces at the end. I think that's fair to say.
And the gimmick does everything for you. So if you want a restoration where you've got what looks like bits, and then you go like this and shake it and it restores to one card, I've got to tell you, the gimmick is ingenious.
Yeah.
It looks fantastic.
It works. Because I actually opened it and went, that's not going to work.
Yeah.
And then within minutes, we were both going, dun-dun. Quite addictive, actually.
Making it restore.
Yeah.
It looks good.
Yeah.
The restoration looks great. Now, here's my issue with it. I don't think it's a strong enough trick on its own. It's not a featured piece because you haven't got that piece by piece.
Yeah, it's not Reformation, is it?
Yeah, it doesn't build. It's not signed, so it's not a featured piece. It almost needs to be used like Christopher uses it on the DVD, where he's just got a few people around. He has a card chosen. Perhaps he's leading into another routine.
Yeah.
But he kind of goes rip, rip, rip. Here's my main gripe with it, and I've got to be 100% honest on the Wizard Product Review. I don't think the ripping looks convincing.
I like the restore. I was not convinced. I was worried that other people wouldn't be so sure that A, they were actually torn up, or they were actually witnessing somebody tear a card, and B, they're necessarily... I mean, it kind of does look like they're all torn up at the end, but there's something that's just not quite right there, isn't there?
I've done gigs with Wayne Fox, and everybody watches this knows I'm a good friend of Wayne's, and I've seen him do his TNR Lightspeed, and he's got a new version as well, where what I like about that, and what I was hoping this was a slight free version of TNR Lightspeed.
Yeah.
Because Wayne does and teaches the move very, very well with TNR Lightspeed, where he just kind of goes bang and it looks like the card on top restores. And his new version that he's got coming out is even better. But I was hoping this was a card that could be on the top of the deck. So you saw pieces like this. And I saw like a secret video of this that Chris shared with Magic Dealers a long time ago. And when he was showing how the card worked, I was thinking, damn, that's clever. If that can be on top of the deck, you see all the pieces and then you literally go like this and it restores, that's going to look great. It isn't that, sadly. It's not quite as clean as that, the restoration. It looks like it's a different kind of restoration where you shake and it restores. I like it. I like the fact that it's
the gimmick. As a magician, you're looking at the gimmick and it's like, oh, it's a nice toy for the magician to
play. Very clever.
Very clever. And it works. But is it... The thing is, with the Torn and Restored, the audience have to be 100% completely convinced that those pieces are torn up at the beginning of the trick. If they're not, then no matter how great the rest of the routine is, the routine's flawed.
Yeah.
Because they weren't sure that they were ripped up.
I know,
at the beginning.
I probably shouldn't. I'm not sure if Wayne's bringing out his new version, but I know I keep going on about it. But with his, the card gets signed. As he's tearing it up, people in the same crowd see the same torn up card being torn front and back. Pieces go on top of the deck. Bang, it restores. That to me looks a lot better. Whereas when you see Chris doing it, you know, you're kind of watching it going, something's going on there. That card's not really being torn up, I think. Maybe it flies in the real world, but I was kind of watching it a little bit uncomfortable thinking, I personally would not get away with that. I'd be guilty as I performed it.
Yeah.
Is that fair to say?
100% fair to say.
I think it's difficult. Chris does it a lot better, but even though I see Chris doing it and I'm not convinced, so I know if I can't see Chris do it and think, God damn, that looks like he's tearing that card up, and I'm not seeing that myself, I can't really be passionate about it myself, even though the gimmick is ingenious. It's very, very clever. So if you've got your own way to do it, to structure it,
if you can make the tear look clean.
Yeah. If you can convince people that you've torn up a card and then you end up with pieces here and you're shaking it and it restores, or maybe you're going to do a video and it doesn't really matter how genuine the video is and you can chop into it, you can make this look absolutely incredible.
That's the challenge.
Yeah.
The challenge is, if you're in the market for a torn and restored card, the restore's quite nice, but your challenge with this is how do you make the tears look completely convincing?
Yeah, absolutely. It's hard to say because I like bits about it, but there's so much I didn't like that would stop me from using it. But Christopher is very passionate about this project. It warrants a release. There's a DVD with it, and it's about an hour and 20 minutes. And he goes into lots of different things with predictions. He shows you how to remake the card, how to fix the card. If you want to do the effect, it's a very fair project. It's just not something that I'm going to do. I'm going to give it 70% exactly.
68% from me.
That's it this week for the Wizard Product Review. We'll see you in 2 weeks' time. Don't forget that worker special only lasts till 12 midnight. On Friday, order from worldmagicshop.com, built to marker by Nicholas Einhorn, and you will get an iPhone absolutely free sent with your order. Until next time, I'm Dave.
And I'm Sean.
See you next time on the Wizard Product Review.